Tell me how old you are without telling me how old you are. Nah, I'm not that old. I'm something like this old. So when I was a kid I liked playing Warblade, but I know its ancestors, games like Galaga or Space Invaders from the beginning, were blazing the rails for game development. I also think it is a great game idea to start with the development journey, so let's start a tutorial for beginners on making a really simple space shooter game in Defold. If you haven't yet downloaded Defold, you can do so from the official website defold.com. Go to download and select the version for your operating system. I am using Ubuntu and I've already had it set up on my machine. After downloading the zip package, simply extract it and run Defold. No installation is needed. You can also download Defold from Steam, so you will also know how much time you spend on it. When you open Defold, you see the homepage with your projects if you started any. Let's start with a new project out of an empty project template. Name it however you like and click Create New Project. After just a few seconds, the template should be downloaded and the editor should be opened. To familiarize yourself with Defold core concepts and the editor, check out my other video. For now, let's start with examining the game.project file. Here you can see basic configuration for your game, name of your project and so on. Check out the Bootstrap tab and open the Bootstrap collection from which your game will start. It's empty now, so we can start adding things here. At first, add a basic game object and add the component of type sprite. Select the image for the sprite. Use for now the built-in source. Choose the default animation and you will immediately see it in the editor. Use the key F to fit the view for selected component. Move your game object a little bit up and right. Now save it with Ctrl or Command S and run it with Ctrl B. You will see your game object with the attached sprite. This little dot is your hello to the world. All these shortcuts we were using right now are worth remembering, but you can also select those commands from the menus. For example, to fit the view to the selection, go to View, Frame Selection. To save everything, go to File, Save All. Notice there is always a hint for a shortcut on such actions. I will most probably use the shortcuts automatically in the meanwhile, especially for saving. Notice that any unsaved changes in your project have an asterisk mark near the name. When it disappears, it means I simply used Ctrl+S shortcut to save everything. To build our game, select Project, Build. Okay, so what have we done already? We ran our main collection, which included one game object with one sprite attached. We selected the image source, aka Atlas, and one of the animations defined in such Atlas. In this case, a single frame image of a radial gradient blob. Later on, we could change it to something different. We changed this in properties of the selected component, a component we selected in the outline. You see, there are other properties, position, rotation, scale, but also material and blend mode. This is something we might want to change in the future, when we would like some special rendering effects for sprite, but for now we could use the default values. We didn't add any file to our project yet, so we didn't touch the left side of the editor, the asset pane. All we did was modifying the opened collection file called main collection, and everything is saved in this file. Many things we could add easily to the collection or game objects, but those are not all components you can add. Some of them can't be just written to collections. They need to be created as separate files in your project. For example, scripts. So if we want to attach a logic to our game object, we need to create such script file. Let's do it right now. We will need some code to handle player inputs and move our starship anyway. You can again use the menu File, New, or shortcut Ctrl+N to add a new file to your project. A window will appear with all possible components. Choose Script. Type its name, for example Player, use the default location and click Create Script button. The file will be added to the selected location and it will be also opened in the main editor view. Another way of adding files is to right-click on selected location and click New Script. Now only a window for a file name and location will appear, because you already selected the type of the component. Okay, by default, the script includes all special default lifecycle functions like init, final, update, and so on. For clarity, I will remove all of them except init and onInput, as we will need them. Default scripts are written in Lua, an ultimately easy to learn language, you'll see. It is perfectly described in Fireship's video, Lua in 100 seconds.
Lua, a fast, multi-paradigm scripting language famous for being so underrated. Imagine a language that's easier to learn than Python, while also being faster and more portable than Python.
What a voice. Never mind, but do check out Fireship YouTube channel. As you see in the comments here, that if you want the script to receive the inputs in onInput, you need to enable it by sending a proper message to this game object. This dot here is exactly a shorthand for this game object. It simply means, hey game object, I want you to literally acquire input focus, so you could receive input from the player. You could then handle it in onInput function. So copy this line to init function or write it down for some practice. Then, inside onInput function, write down a simple if condition, where you check if the action ID received here is equal to the value of the hashed string left. And analogical in else if condition, if it is equal to the hashed right. What does this hash mean? To put it simply, it converts this string to some unique number, and that number will be mapped to a proper input action. It's easier and way more performant for engine to operate on hashes than on literal strings, and by design action IDs in default are hashes. To know exactly what hashes could be used as input, take a look at the special input binding file. Here you see all input triggers that could be registered by default engine and sent to our script as an input action. In key triggers, click the plus icon. Select left from the list of all key triggers. It is mapped with the left arrow key on a keyboard. Type action ID next to it, for example just left. Do the same for the right arrow key. Save it and get back to our script. We would like this starship to move to the left and to the right when the player presses arrow keys. So for the game object we will set position to anyone. As I typed right now, I'm using a function setPosition from default's GO API, which stands for GameObject, and you can, like this one, control the GameObject with this function here. We will change the GameObject's position a little bit to the left, but first we need to get position of the object. I will also use a function from the GameObject API and store it in a local variable. Then I will subtract a little from its x-coordinate to move it to the left and use it in our setPosition function. We could copy it to also handle the right key, but only replace the subtraction with addition, so we will move the object a little bit to the right on x-axis. Save it and make this magic circle move with your mouse as I am doing. Last thing is that we should attach this script to our game object as a component. Right-click on the game object in outline of the main collection and click Add Component File. Select our script and click OK. It should be now added as a component. Again, save everything and build our game and check if the input is working and you can fly this ship. Maybe one last thing before we finish the basics tutorial for now. I have some sprites prepared for our game. This is something you might want to draw by yourself, or like me, utilize some assets from, for example, itch.io. If you have one, you can now add it to our project. I will create a separate directory for the graphical and maybe audio files in the future. Let's call it assets and drag and drop here your image. How you structure your project is totally on your own, but it's worth knowing the assets pane in default is reflecting your project folder in your operating system. You can add directories and files using a regular Fire Explorer and they will appear here, or use the assets pane in the default and they will be then also on your drive or wherever you have your project. Then create the atlas file. Name it however you like. Right click in the outline of this atlas and click Add Animation Group. Animations can then be played in sprite components, so we will prepare the first one for the player's spaceship. Rename the default ID to player, and if it is an animation, define its frame per second ratio and playback mode. For example, loop forward will loop your animation forever. I am using only one static image for the spaceship, so I don't need any changes here. I could maybe just select another playback mode, the one called none, and then right click on your animation in outline to add images. Select the one you just moved to your project and represents the spaceship. It will appear in the editor view. The atlas will be automatically adjusted to fit some power of two dimensions for optimization purposes, but this is nothing you need to be taking care of right now. Now go back to your main collection and change the properties of the sprite of our game object. Select Image and choose our new atlas file, and then change default animation property to our animation of the spaceship. Save it and run again to see your ship in space. Let's sum it up. We learned how to add game objects and components to the main collection. We added a sprite to our spaceship, and then we replaced it too, with a custom image from an atlas we created. And we learned some shortcuts to quickly save and build our game. We also learned how to add scripts and write some logic in Lua. Finally, we defined and started handling input actions from the keyboard to control our spaceship. That would be enough for one tutorial, I think. In the next one, we will continue our project and we'll add some enemies, collision objects, and bullets to make some action-packed gameplay loop.